I have been pulling all netters for the past 3 or so days in an effort to compile as much data as possible into a single video without wasting 30 minutes of your time. So let's get started with the Ryzen 2700X CPU, the subject of today's video. I've got about a dozen or so gaming benchmarks to throw your way, along with a few synthetics. I even have an Adobe Premiere render benchmark if you're interested in content creating with the CPU, and I'll also have a few talking points at the end we can extract from this data. My test benches today consist of the three CPUs listed in the title of this video, which I hope you read, along with respective Z and X chipset boards, and 16 gigabytes of Corsair Vengeance RGB RAM clocked to 3000 megahertz. All three CPUs were cooled with the Deepcool Captain 360EX AIO, and all games were benchmarked in tandem with the EVGA 1070 Ti for the Win 2 triple slot graphics card. This one's beefy alright, but she stays nice and quiet under load. The Ryzen 7 2700X, a part of the family codenamed Pinnacle Ridge, is an improvement on an architectural level over its 1000 series counterparts, and it chose to compare it to the 1700X because it falls right in line from a nomenclature standpoint, and should from a price standpoint as well. The new 12 nanometer process results in an evident IPC jump of around 5% or so in my testing. It might be a bit higher depending on what you're doing, and at no expense of additional power, and even when overclocked well beyond 4 gigahertz, the CPU stayed well within my comfort zone from a temperature standpoint. This was a relief since the two boards included in my reviewer kit from AMD included supplemental 4 and 8-pin EPS ports, and on top of the, you know, standard 8-pin port. Consumers have not seen anything like this since X299, but fear not, I recorded only 150 watts of peak power draw from the 12-volt leads on both EPS cables while torture testing with Prime95, signifying an only marginal jump in power demand with the new architecture. Now, a few things to keep in mind before moving to the benchmarks. The 1700X was clocked to 4 GHz on all scenarios, the 2700X was clocked to 4.2 GHz, unless otherwise stated, and the 8700K to 5 GHz. This is again across all cores. The 1070 Ti was left at stock frequencies. So let's start things off with Cinebench R15. Essentially a thread image render tool, these scores rely on architectural efficiency and clock speed. We can see the IPC jump from the 1700X to the 2700X in a relative sense via the blue bars to the left, since these tests were conducted at the same frequency. 159 to 171 isn't too substantial, but the overclocking headroom on top of this is where the money is. I was able to push mine to 4.2 GHz across all 8 cores on 1.385 volts and a level 1 load line calibration. The result is a whopping 1905 CB on the multi-core side of things, practically dwarfing that of the 8700K. Where the blue team shines, however, is overclockability, of course. 5 GHz pushes its single core performance well above 200 CB, which is why it has remained the gaming king up to this point. But focusing more on the improvements with Ryzen, Geekbench 4 gives us a closer look at the kinds of raw horsepower gains one should experience when migrating from Ryzen 1. The additional overclocking headroom at the expense of marginal power loads is a huge win for the second gen stuff. That, and I can finally use XMP profiles without my entire PC shutting down. This was always a complaint I had with Ryzen 1. From a content creation standpoint, the Ryzen 7 2700X renders a 5-minute 1080p video clip, 60fps mind you, in practically the same time as its higher clocked blue team counterpart. Clock for clock, the red team has this one in the bag. You can even stream Netflix while you're at it, just to be cocky. The first game on our list, as always, is Grand Theft Auto 5. All games, by the way, have been tested in the 1080p resolution. It's the most common by far, and it does leverage CPU and GPU horsepower fairly evenly across the board. GTA 5 is an excellent port for what it is, and this one yields some of the best gains for the 2700X over the 1700X, jumping from 109 to 133, and then only an extra 6 FPS on average between the 2700X and the 8700K is pretty phenomenal. The lowest 1% and 0.1% of all frame rates are also maintained here, which is where the boosted clock speed truly shines. PUBG is up next. Optimization isn't yet on point, so in-game settings were lowered in most places to compensate. The 8700K performs the best here, but only barely. Only a 6 FPS delta between it and the 2700X for both average and 1% charting. Again, pretty incredible. The 2700X does fall a bit short though in the lowest 0.1% of frames, which could be the result of any number of variables, including how my own gameplay played out, since nothing in this benchmark was truly standardized. Moving from PUBG now to Fortnite's Battle Royale in 1080p with a high preset, things are looking up across the board. 166 FPS on average for the 8700K, 146 for the 2700X, and 139 for the 1700X. The gap between Intel and AMD widens just a bit with this title, and it certainly runs smoother on the i7. Up next is Doom, tested in OpenGL for benchmarking purposes, where we see a similar story with respect to averages. Intel takes the cake here, and oddly enough, the 2700X suffered tremendously down low, with its lowest 1% and 0.1% of frame times. I'd like to test Vulkan in the future to see how this fares out. I'm not too sure at this point what attributed to the dip in frame rates down low. F1 2017 has a great built-in benchmark. I always run the Australian map in heavy rain to load up the hardware, and things in this case spread out just a bit more. Intel's still on top, but a clear advantage exists with the 2700X over the last gen. Sure, the minimum was a tad lower, but things looked especially smooth in-game, and for all we know, that 92 could be an outlier, which is why percentage-based frame rate charting is generally more representative of overall trends. Universe Sandbox 2 is a relatively demanding title for what it is, thanks to active algorithms and particle mapping, and in the same Earth and Sphere of Moon simulation that I always use, the 2700X fell massively short of the gaming king, 86 on average compared to a mere 60. However, things down low are much closer, 30 versus 29 for the lowest 1%, and 27 versus 21 for the lowest 0.1%. Rise of the Tomb Raider in DirectX 12 is another title I was interested in testing due to its inherent NVIDIA bias, so I was curious to see how things would play out. The 2700X actually lost to the 1700X in one of the scenarios, but pulled ahead in the latter two, while staying within 10 or so frames of the 8700K on the other side. Battlefield 1 is a game in which we should expect extra cores to do us a solid, and it certainly plays out that way. The 2700X is only 4 frames shy of the 8700K on average, falling slightly further behind with the lower tiers, a 10 FPS delta at 1% and 16 at 0.1%. Still though, we see noticeable gains over the 1700X, 8 cores and 16 threads clocked only 200 MHz higher than a baseline can make a heck of a difference on top of added architectural benefits. I threw in Planet Coaster for fun because it's actually pretty intensive in the Ultra preset, even on the CPU. The trends are to be expected, but the 8700K does pull away with the lower frame rate percentages. And lastly, Witcher 3, an especially graphics intensive title. The 2700X averaged 112 FPS, leading the 1700X by only 5 frames, and falling short of the 8700K by 8. A similar story continues further down the line, but it should be noted that numerical improvements can and do exist with the 2700X over Gen 1 architecture. So, AMD is getting awfully close to outperforming the 8700K, the gaming king, in major titles, all the while boasting additional cores and competitive prices for that multitasking fun. Speaking of which, that's been Ryzen's calling all along, value and multitasking. They never claim to be the best gaming CPUs on the market, they're just clearly better value CPUs. And with the 2700X closing a 5% frame rate margin on average between itself and the 8700K, things are only looking better. At this point, the platform's had several months to mature, second-gen chips are backwards compatible with last year's boards, something Intel should seriously pick up on, and pricing is, well, attractive, no other word for it. So I want to close with a few additional remarks regarding my experience with the platform and with the 2700X in particular. I haven't, by the way, even pulled the 2600X out of its box, I'll get to that one shortly, this video is all about the 2700X. But what I've noticed is that these CPUs don't really run as hot as I expected them to. I don't think I had the best overclocker though, I think 4.2 GHz across all cores is pretty meh, just considering one core at least will turbo to 4.3, that's what it says on the box anyway, I haven't actually checked that because I overclocked immediately, but it's impressive, but it just really depends on the chip. It's more or less a silicon lottery, luck of the draw type thing, and if you get a really good chip, wow, you're gonna be into 2000 CB territory for Cinebench, and I imagine your frame rates will be just neck and neck with that of the 8700Ks. And there's something else, the MSI board I used decided to pump 1.52 volts under the auto config to the CPU vCore, which is just a bit uncomfortable. I think 1.5 is definitely too high, not just for the 360mm AIO, but also the VRMs and the CPU itself, right? So the board did get pretty hot under torture workloads with Prime95 even at 1.4 volts or thereabouts where I had it, which is something to keep in mind. The temperatures weren't too bad, but having a top-down CPU cooler, an air cooler in particular, would keep those VRMs nice and cool. If you have some intakes or exhaust fans at the top of your case, that will also do your VRMs a solid. Now from a value standpoint, Pinnacle Ridge definitely has it. If you can pick up the 2700X for anything near $300 USD, you'll be sitting good in the value neighborhood. neighborhood in my book, almost as good as feeling like you're ripped off a used car salesman, which, let's be honest, really doesn't happen too much. This CPU is a steal for the suggested retail price of $329 and should pose a worthy upgrade for anyone touting architecture as far back as I would say Ivy Bridge and maybe even Piledriver or Bulldozer. If you're looking for a workstation and multitasking CPU that can still write games in 1080p and up, then the 2700X is for you. Don't be afraid, by the way, to check it out via the link below. At least consider it, especially if you're on an older platform. Now I want to know what you think. Is Pinnacle Ridge something you're considering? How do you feel about the platform, especially after watching this video and other reviewer videos out there? I invite you to comment down below, like this video if you thought it was cool, and subscribe for more content like this. This is Cyan Studio. Thanks for benchmarking with us.